Greetings. This is part 4, reviewing an Islamic poem titled O Christ Worshippers. The author, Ibn Qayyim, lived from 1292 to 1350. You'll notice virtually nothing has changed in the arguments Islam tries in the past 700 years. Let's get to the next refrain and see what awaits an answer.
Was the whole entity or universe left without a sustainer? So who answered the prayers? Were the heavens vacated when he laid under the ground somewheres?
I am not making this up. You will hear this very same argument issued from the streets of Londonistan to the kingdom of darkness of Saudi Arabia. The basic Islamic argument, based on Islamic ignorance, is this. If Jesus was God and Jesus died, then who was God while God was dead? And while Muslims rarely state it, they do not have a coherent definition or doctrine of death. But their arguments hint that death means ceasing to exist. The test is to substitute the definition back into the text. Let's see if this changes or clarifies the meaning.
Was the whole entity, universe, left without a sustainer when Christ was dead and God did not exist? So who answered the prayers?
Boy, that seems to be real clear now, and the meaning is unchanged. If God did not exist, or maybe was incapacitated, who answered your prayers? I'm sure the atheists would vote for the former before the latter.
Were the heavens vacated when Christ was dead and God did not exist, when he laid under the ground somewheres?
I guess, since I know death does not mean cease to exist, this clause does not read as well. But the logical supposition and conclusion are the same.
If Jesus was God and Jesus died, while Jesus was dead, God was dead. So there was no God on duty.
And this is how Islam taught people to think 700 years ago. And this is how Islam teaches people to think to this very day. What then is the logical Christian answer to this problem that has defied the minds of Muslim men and women for at the very least 700 years? We now return you to our regularly scheduled program, already in progress. Our final Jeopardy category is Truths Revealed by the Comforter. This truth, revealed by the Comforter, arises from God's apparent quantum entanglement. And Joe Christian, what is your answer?
What is the Trinity?
That is correct. And what did you wager?
My eternal soul, Alex.
That places you in the lead, Joe. And Mustafa Muslim, what is your answer?
There is no Illah but Allah.
I'm sorry, Mustafa, but that is not in the form of a question. And we would have considered, who is Allah greater than, also incorrect. And what did you wager?
An eternity with 72 perpetual virgins.
Sorry, Mustafa, you wind up with 0 virgins. The correct answer to Final Jeopardy is, what is the Trinity? Though we would also accept, who are the Trinity? This doctrine properly explains Yahweh's ability to be both alive on the throne and dead in the grave for 3 days.
Wait, there is no Illah but Allah. How does the Trinity explain anything? Allah says, say not three.
To the minute when the rapture will happen. Let's answer the poet with scriptures from the message of the prophets and the apostles of the living God. But first I will offer an example of bad, circular reasoning. The Bible talks of God in the Bible in 3 ways: Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. From this, we observe the count of 3. From this, we coined the word Trinity. But we cannot then turn around and say Jesus is God because Jesus is in the Trinity. This would be an example of circular logic. Instead, we must consider an example of a riddle, one that Jesus himself offered to the Pharisees.
Matthew 22:41. Now, while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them a question. What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he? They said to him, the son of David. Notice and keep in mind, this refers to the Christ, the Messiah, the Messiah, who we all believe is Jesus. What do you think about the Christ, the Messiah, the Messiah? Jesus. Whose son is he? They said to him, the son of David. He said to them, then how does David in the Spirit call him Lord, saying, how does David, prophesying by the Spirit of God, then say the following? How does David refer to the Messiah as Lord, meaning his Lord? Matthew 22:44.
Oops, a typo.
The Lord said to my Lord. Yahweh, the Lord God, said to my Lord, the Messiah. This is from Psalm 110:1, a Psalm of David. Yahweh, the Lord, says to my Lord, La'adonai, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Adonai is the same root word used for God in the neutered Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord Adonai, our God, the Lord Adonai, is one. I call it the neutered Shema because it comes from Moses in Deuteronomy. Hear, O Israel, the Lord Yahweh, our God, the Lord Yahweh, is one. He said to them, then how does David in the Spirit call him Lord, saying, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies beneath your feet. We have Prophet David recording a conversation between Yahweh God and the Messiah, whom David calls Adonai, God. You may be tempted to think this is simply God using the royal we, like Allah does. But you would be wrong, because use of the royal we is always to someone else. The royal we is a self-reference and not a self-discussion. If David then calls him, the Messiah, Lord, how is he, the Messiah, his, David's, son? No one was able to answer him a word. Nor did anyone dare from that day on to ask him another question. Their rigid monotheism could not answer, nor can any Muslim answer. In fact, there is only one way that a coherent answer can be given, and that is an answer open to ponder God's revelation of himself. But are there any other such self-references where God speaks to himself or about himself in a decidedly third-person way? Let us examine Malachi 3:1. Behold, I am going to send my messenger, and he will clear the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. Messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. Let us first notice where Yahweh God, who is speaking through Prophet Malachi, refers to himself. Behold, I, going to send my messenger, will clear the way before me, says the Lord of hosts. These four self-references all clearly mean Yahweh. Now reread the first sentence as a whole sentence. Behold, I am going to send my messenger and he will clear the way before me. Yahweh God is coming and he will send a prophet to prepare his way. But there is another someone, another person mentioned in the center of this verse. And the Lord whom you seek will come to his temple, messenger or prophet of the covenant, in whom you delight. He is coming. Remember, this is Yahweh God speaking. And Yahweh God says this individual will come to His temple. His is a pronoun referring to someone other than the speaker. If I say His message, I could mean God's message, Malachi's message, or the message of this other individual God mentions. It is unclear who I refer to, but it clearly does not refer to me, the person speaking. So when God refers to someone coming to His temple, God means the temple belongs to this other individual. This is confirmed because the sentence establishes the antecedent. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to His temple. The individual coming to His temple is the Lord you seek. There are other references by God of another with His attributes, His glory, and more. But do not confuse that as another separate God, because Yahweh God has clearly, directly addressed that error. Isaiah 42:8, I am Yahweh, the Lord. That is my name. I will not share my glory with anyone else, or the praise due me with idols. So Yahweh refutes the claim of another God separate from Himself. And the process of understanding the truth means harmonizing that clear, absolute statement with the following. John 17:5, Now, Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. The phrase, which I had with you, means shared, and is worded that way in some translations. Now, Father, bring me into the glory we shared before the world began. New Living Translation. Prophet Isaiah reveals God giving a son who will be called Deity. Isaiah 9:6, For a child will be born unto us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and his name, the son's name, will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. We Christians think it obvious when God, by Prophet Isaiah, speaks of a son called Mighty God, the son, a child who will be born. We think it obvious that God was not speaking of Himself, but was still speaking of a divine, holy being. But we know that we know God will not share His glory with another separate God. I am Yahweh, that is my name. I will not share my glory with anyone else. It is only by respecting God's whole message that the true and full understanding may be achieved. And this is a huge difference between God's message and Muhammad's message. Muhammad invented abrogation, so he could change his message and delete parts when his sayings conflicted, contradicted, or became confused. The Bible simply has no such concept of abrogation. What? What's that you ask? You think the New Covenant abrogates the Old Covenant? I understand the confusion you may have, O Muslim, because you think any change may be construed as abrogation. Why does the New Covenant replacing the Old Covenant not constitute abrogation? That is a topic for a whole new video, brother. To summarize this point, Jesus is this other identifiable character God speaks of. And Jesus Himself, who referred to Himself as the Son of Man, did so with a purpose. Matthew 26:64. You have said it yourself, Jesus answered. But I say to all of you, from now on you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven. And the Son of Man is described by the prophet as having godlike qualities. Daniel 7:13. I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven, and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting or eternal dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. There are simply too many revelations by the prophets to ignore a uniquely identifiable character who was God and is one with God, and yet not a separate deity. When Jesus died, God the Father was still alive, on the throne, and answering prayers, doing all the righteous things a human mind imagines God would be doing. The mysterious thing God did was the thing beyond the imagination of man, and therefore beyond the understanding of men unwilling to listen to God reveal and explain himself by the prophets. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.